Simon & Schuster Audio presents Tough Customer by Sandra Brown. Read by Victor Slezak.
He was out of the truck while dust around the tires was still rising. The ambulance's emergency light sent pulsing shafts of color into the surrounding forest. His boots crunched in the gravel as he covered the distance to the porch in three long strides. He entered the house through the open front door, stepping into a wide foyer. His eyes swept the main room on his left. Two empty wine glasses were on the coffee table in front of a slip-covered sofa. He registered it all within seconds. Beyond the living room was a dining area rimmed by a bay window, but he left off exploration when noises from above drew his gaze up to the gallery, which ran the width of the house. Taking the stairs two at a time, he rounded the landing, making sure not to touch the newel post, and proceeded up to the second floor. He walked along the gallery that led him into a short hallway into an open bedroom door. The EMTs were kneeling on either side of a prone figure, a man, judging by the bare feet and hairy legs, which was all of him that could be seen from this vantage point. Under the man, blood had soaked into the rug. One of the EMTs glanced over his shoulder and bobbed his head in greeting. "Hey, Ski, we've been expecting you. What have you got?" "Messy GSW to the lower left torso." "Is he gonna make it?"
"Don't know yet. The lady said he was conscious right up till we got here."
"Lady?" Ski asked.
The first EMT nodded into an open doorway, which they were presently blocking.
"She called in the 911.
"Name?"
"King."
"Caroline King, the realtor?" Ski asked with surprise. "This is her house? So who's the guy that got shot?"
"Lady said his name is Ben Laughlin."
"Are they the only two in the house?"
"Appear to be. She's shaken up pretty bad."
"Did she shoot him?"
"That's your job," the woman EMT replied.
Satisfied that the shooting victim was stabilized enough to transport, the two competently placed him on the stretcher they'd carried up with them, affording Ski a better look at him. He appeared to be in his mid-30s. He had even features and the trim build of a runner or tennis player. Hearing the clomping of footsteps, Ski turned just as another deputy barged into the room, then drew up short.
"I got here as soon as I could," he huffed.
His wide-eyed gaze moved past Ski to the dark, wet bloodstain on the rug, then to the victim on the stretcher. He was younger than Ski by more than a decade, nearly a foot shorter, soft around the middle. He was a rookie. This was his first shooting. To him, it must represent the big time.
"Give them a hand, will you, Andy? Getting that stretcher around the landing might be tricky. Don't touch anything in the process unless you put on gloves. It's up to you not to let anybody else inside, and that includes our own men."
"Got it."
The younger deputy hiked up his slipping gun belt and accompanied the EMTs out. Ski crossed the room and went to the open door that had been blocked by the fallen victim. He looked into a bathroom where a woman was sitting on the rim of the tub, rocking back and forth, her elbows on her knees, her head in her hands. A summer weight cotton robe had been carelessly tied at her waist. The wide sleeves had fallen back to reveal slender arms sprinkled with pale freckles. She wasn't Caroline King. Inside the bathtub, the porcelain was wet. A bottle of shampoo in the corner of the tub was uncapped. She must have been interrupted while taking a shower, which explained the damp patches where her robe was stuck to her skin. Lying on the floor a few inches from her feet, incongruous with the vulnerability of her pink bare toes, was a .38 revolver, a standard Saturday night special. He removed a pair of latex gloves from the hip pocket of his jeans and worked his right hand into one of them, then cautiously walked forward and bent down to pick up the revolver by the trigger guard. He thumbed the latch, and the cylinder swung out.
There was an unspent bullet in each of the six chambers. He sniffed the barrel. It hadn't been fired recently. As though only then realizing that he was there, the woman lowered her hands from her face and looked up at him.
Is he all right?
Not really. Whimpering, she looked past Ski to the bloodstain just beyond the threshold.
I can't believe this happened.
He unsnapped the leather wallet on his belt and opened it to show her his ID.
Deputy Ski Nyland, Merritt County, Sheriff's Office.
I see. But Ski didn't believe she actually did. She'd barely glanced at his ID. Her watery gaze was imploring.
Please, tell me he's going to be okay.
What's your name? She seemed to have to think about it.
Barry Malone.
Ski noted that her last name wasn't the same as that of the man who'd been shot. Neither of them was named King. He said,
The wounded man, Ben Laughlin, is that right?
She gave an abrupt nod. He's on his way to the ER.
He bled a lot.
He did, yeah.
He can't die.
Unfortunately, he can.
I must call his wife.
Ski planted his feet wider on the bathroom floor tiles.
What happened here tonight, Miss Malone?
Is this your pistol? Did you shoot Laughlin with it? He didn't believe she had, at least not using the pistol now in his possession. But he wanted to see what kind of reaction he'd get by asking. She dropped her hands from her face and gaped at him.
No!
She surged to her feet, reeled slightly, then steadied herself by placing a hand on the edge of the pedestal sink.
I didn't get out the pistol until after I'd called 911.
After you'd called 911. Her head bobbed in affirmation. She gulped a breath.
I was afraid. Afraid he would come back.
Who? Before she could answer, sounds of a commotion downstairs reached them. A door slammed. Voices were raised. Apparently, Barry Malone recognized the woman's voice, because suddenly she gave a sharp cry and slipped past Ski through the bathroom door.
Hey!
He was careful to hurdle the bloodstain on the rug as he chased after her. Midway across the bedroom, he made a grab for her arm, but came up with only a handful of cotton fabric. She whirled around and yanked it from his grip, but not before he got an eyeful. Then in a flash of bare skin and printed textile, she vanished through the bedroom door. Ski went after her, crossed the gallery in a run, and bolted down the stairs, hot on her heels. When his cell phone's jingle pulled him from a deep sleep, Dodge figured the caller was Derek. Likely, his employer had had one of his famous middle-of-the-night brainstorms and wanted Dodge to act upon it immediately.
Yeah.
Dodge? Surprised to hear a woman's voice, he sat up and swung his feet to the floor. Have I reached Dodge Hanley?
Yeah.
This is Caroline? Caroline King? As if she needed to specify which Caroline. Fair to say that you're surprised to hear from me?
Yeah.
That seemed to be the only word he was capable of uttering. I apologize for the hour, she said. It's late here, and I realize it's an hour later in Atlanta. I mean, I assume you're still in Atlanta.
Yeah.
How are you? Are you well?
Yeah. Shit. Had he forgotten the language? Find some other words, for Christ's sake. I'm okay, you know. Okay.
He was okay except for a total brain shutdown, a heart rate that had shot off the charts, and a sudden inability to breathe. Finally, she said, Dodge, I never would have bothered you if not for... I would never ask you for anything, but this is vitally important.
Jesus.
She was sick. She was dying. She needed...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.